Hello everyone, welcome. My name is Sarah Pate and I'm a librarian and the director of the Washington Center for the Book, which is an affiliate of the Library of Congress Center for the Book, administered by Washington State Library, where I work in Olympia. The Washington Center for the Book promotes literacy and a love of books, reading, and libraries. And one of our projects every year is the Washington State Book Awards. And so we're thrilled to have you here tonight to celebrate one of our 2022 Washington State Book Award winners, Margaret Owen. The 2022 Washington State Book Awards were a partnership of the Washington Center for the Book and Seattle Public Library. So I wanted to say a thank you to Linda Johns and Sarah Long for all their help with that project. And I also wanted to say a huge thanks today to Cherise, Jose, and Shelley for helping out with this event as well. And I also want to say a warm welcome to our online attendees. Hello, and thank you for joining. If you have questions during the program, just throw them in the chat and we will do our best to get them to Margaret during the Q&A. We're going to start with Margaret talking a bit about her book and her work, and then we will have a Q&A together. And so now it's my pleasure to introduce Margaret, New York Times bestselling author, Margaret Owen.
I stood up a little premature.
So it's perfect to say it. Was born and raised at the end of the Oregon Trail, and has worked in everything from thrift stores to presidential campaigns. She is the author of the award-winning, critically acclaimed Little Thieves trilogy and the Merciful Crow duology, which have been named an NPR Best Book of the Year, Tor.com Best of the Year, the Elsa Best Fiction for Young Adult Selection, and winner of the 2022 Washington State Book Award for Young Adult Literature. In her free time, she enjoys exploring ill-advised travel destinations, raising money for social justice nonprofits through her illustrated work, and negotiating a hostage situation with her monstrous cats. She lives in Seattle, Washington. So Margaret, congrats again on the award. Thank you for being here.
Thank you so much for having me.
And for letting my book win.
Fun story, when we talked about doing this, I immediately ran to my chat of other authors and was like, what do you do for a library event? And they were like, well, I don't know. It was like solo-wise. And one friend was like, okay, so you just tell your publishing journey, a little bit about the book, and do a reading, and you should be good. And I was like, okay, so we're just going to do that. So, I mean, and also, it kind of like, my publishing journey kind of speaks to the power of doing like school visits and in-person stuff. So when I was in fourth grade, I met an author named Suzanne Fletcher. She came to my school. She was the author of the Dragon's Milk series. I see some of that, yep. And I remember reading that book and being like, wow, this is such a cool idea. But I didn't really like conceptualize that authors were real, that they weren't like unicorns. I just thought that sort of like existed like the stars, right? They're out there, but I can't interact with them. And then I walk in one day, and there's, you know, into the school library, and there she is at the computer, like probably having a real hard time with it because it was, you know, back in the 90s. And I was like, they're real. It's not like Santa Claus. Like this is the whole thing. And I didn't realize it was like actually a job that you could do. And at that point I was like, I want to write all the books that I've been reading all this time. I want to be an author when I grew up. And my parents were like, you want to be an accountant is what you want to do. I mean, they were a lot nicer about that. And I should hope so, because my dad was a graphic designer, so whatever, it's his room to talk, right? But they were supportive, but also from a young age, I was very aware that if you want to be an author, it is like not the, you know, there's a reason that they call them starving artists, right? So I sort of was like, that's something I can do someday. And as a teen, I was still writing in my free time. I was writing just garbage bags full of fan fiction. I was writing my own stories, original stuff. A lot of it was actually comics, because I had, like many children of the early aughts, I was wandering into the realms of manga and anime, right? And I was like, I like these stories because at that time, the state of teen literature was very, it wasn't what it is, like YA isn't what it is today, or it wasn't what it is today. It was a lot more focused on like contemporary stories and a lot of books that were very focused on issues, and they were great. Or like the Princess Diaries, you know, and like I love the Princess Diaries, but it wasn't like, here we're gonna drop a massive tome of, you know, teens going on adventures and dealing with feelings. And it's going to be like a chunker. And it's also going to be in a magical world with dragons. Like, you had little bits of those broken up into middle grade, but you didn't really have all that focused in one thing, unlike what I was finding in, like, manga and anime. So I was like, okay, so this is kind of what I want to do, and I still want to write and tell my own stories, but I don't think I can actually make a living at doing it, right? And so in college and after college, I was working all over the place, like you heard. I was working in, like, thrift stores, I was working on political campaigns, and I got experience from a whole sort of range of things, and that all sort of informed my writing in the long run. But no matter what, I always came back to writing. Like, I always found myself writing and drawing in my spare time. And around early 2013, I sort of had a heart-to-heart with myself, and I said, I don't know what I want to do for a living that isn't writing, but I also know that's not sustainable right now. Like, that's not a viable career path. It's just, you know, go from being from working a 9-to-5 and then be like, I'm going to write and sell a book with nothing in the middle. So I was like, well, I don't need a social life, I guess. And just started writing and drafting my first manuscript. And that basically, I took all of, like, 2013 to write a very overly long manuscript now, which is a trend for me. But at the end of 2013, I started querying it. And does everybody here know about query letters and literary agents? Okay, so this is like part of the how the sausage gets made, and I actually really like this. So, in order for you to sell a book to a publisher, you, like, for the vast majority of publishers, they only accept manuscripts that are represented by a literary agent. And what that means is that, let's say I have a manuscript, and it's about this adorable book, let's say. It's complete, and this is usually for fiction. For nonfiction, you can get away with a proposal if you have a platform. That's a whole other thing. You have this proposal, or you have this manuscript that's complete. You write effectively what is the copy on the back. You write a version of that, and that's called a query letter. And that summary is what you send to an agent, and you say, this is the book that I have. Here are, you know, however many pages that you've asked for as a sample. And you can, you know, if you would like to read more, please get in contact with me. And that is the process of querying. And people will query literally hundreds of agents in their lifetime to find one who's interested in representing their story. It is not uncommon for that to take a very long time. And what a literary agent does, and this is important, because I've seen people be like, what does a literary agent even do? Do I really need one? The answer is yes. They're effectively not quite lawyers, but they are contract experts who go through, and, like, they will send your manuscript to a publisher, to an editor at a publisher. And if the editor decides to buy that manuscript, they then negotiate your deal. Mm-hmm. And that is very important that you have a professional looking through those contracts and saying, oh, well, here's where the publisher has tried to sneak in, we can feed this into an AI. You know, here's where a publisher has said, we want to give you royalties that are like 12% of all paperback sales. Boy, that would actually be a really good rate. And we like that. Or they could say, the publisher wants to give you 5% of all paperback sales after profit. And we actually want that to be a lot more. So that is the kind of stuff that a literary agent does. And also, if you have a dispute with your publisher, then you don't have to duke it out with the publishing staff. The agent will go in and say, hey, I represent this author and also like 50 others who I won't like send to you with their very profitable manuscripts if you don't knock this off. Mm-hmm. So that's effectively what a literary agent does. And querying is the process of pitching your books to those agents. So with that little aside, I started querying at the end of 2014 or end of 2013, early 2014, with a manuscript that will probably never see the light of day. We'll see. I might get, you know, workshopped into something someday. The process of that and like the feedback that I was getting and the insight I was getting impacted how I was sort of approaching different, you know, approaching how I wrote, approaching how I approach, you know, learned how to query, how I learned how to pitch myself and my work. And I was, so I was learning from the experience, even though it was full of rejections, a whole lot of rejections. Like, you can actually learn from those, even as brutal as they can be sometimes. And then at the end of 2014, I got the idea for the book that would become my debut novel, The Merciful Crow. And I was working increasingly stressful jobs over 2015 and 2016, while also querying that first manuscript and drafting, well, querying and revising that first manuscript, and then drafting The Merciful Crow. And so it took a little bit longer than I was hoping. However, I did finish that manuscript the end of 2016, started querying in early 2017 after making a couple of revisions, and I wound up landing an agent in early spring, and then we sold it at the end of June, which was pretty cool, and it was for a three-book deal. That three-book deal was for The Merciful Crow, its sequel, The Faithless Hawk, and an untitled standalone YA fantasy. And there was some turmoil getting to the point, but eventually that third book is what would become Little Thieves. Mm-hmm. And it's like several years in the making. So Little Thieves is basically, I've taken some liberties with a fairy tale. So does anybody know the story of the Goose Girl? Excellent. Well, for anybody who doesn't, and this is also a little bit about why I chose to dig into this one. The Goose Girl is basically a 50,000 foot view. It is about a maid who steals the identity of the princess that she served, makes the princess work as a servant in the castle, and then once eventually, you know, the maid's scam is figured out, she dies horribly, the princess is restored, everybody lives happily ever after. Except, this is where I was like, I have some questions. There is a crux in the story, like that moment that's sort of pitched as like, or not pitched, because you don't pitch a fairy tale. They already exist. They don't need to be pitched. But in the story, it is framed as like the big sort of hinge moment for this entire conflict is when the princess and the maid are traveling to the kingdom where the princess is soon to be wed. And the princess like calls everything to a stop and tells the maid to get down off her horse and go get her water. And the maid says, "You are actually equally capable of getting down and getting your own water." And this is framed as also not just like the beginning of the worst thing that could possibly happen to this princess, because she gets off of her horse. She loses the protection charm that was saving her from who knows what. The maid at this point is like, aha, steals her identity. And it is pretty, you know, and like, this is horrible. Except it's presented as this evil maid made the you know, fair, kind, beautiful princess wear the awful rags that this maid was wearing, and made her ride the nasty horse that this maid was riding. And at no point is it asked why the princess's employee was existing in this kind of state, why it was okay for this to be the norm for the maid, but not for the princess, but it was the worst thing that could happen to this princess. And that's where Little Thieves came from, because I wanted to investigate, you know, like, I would be like, you know, maybe in the maid's shoes, I would probably also be like, no, it's my time to ride the nice horse, like, you know, like, this should be pretty straightforward. I'm doing a lot of the work to maintain all of this. Maybe I should get to enjoy a little bit of it. So, for those of you who don't know, Little Thieves is the story of the maid, Vanya. She has, at this point, been the life of the princess. You know, she stole the identity, and it's been about a year. She's used that identity to infiltrate high society parties and rob jewels from the nobility, specifically to fund an escape from her rather overbearing adoptive godparents, or godmother specifically, death and fortune. And then one night, she robs the wrong family and gets cursed by their patron deity to turn into jewels herself, unless she can make up for everything that she's stolen including the identity of the princess, which is where things get a little bit awkward. And to make things worse, the princess's awful fiancé is suddenly coming back and demanding a marriage in or wedding in like 2 weeks. And he's also brought a highly trained investigator to figure out who this thief who's been plaguing all the nobility is. And so she has a whole, you know, basically 2 weeks to figure all that out. And it's a little bit of a mess for her, but it's a lot of fun. And I think, yeah, that is what I got for that. So I was going to do a little bit of a reading of the scene specifically where Vanya gets cursed. And then I think we've got time for a Q&A after that. So I am going to sit for this. Because otherwise I will be probably wobbling and falling all over something. All right. So for a little bit of context, as the goddaughter of fortune, amongst other things, Vanya can see bad luck and good luck in the real world. And bad luck manifests as like coal dust, and good luck manifests as like this sort of lovely golden shimmer. All right. And in this scene, she is in the middle of returning from robbing the family that we will regret to find out she shouldn't have robbed. All right. It takes a moment for me to realize that the coach isn't moving anymore. I peek out from the firs. The muted drum rolls of hoofbeats have fallen silent, and beyond the coach windows, I only see pitch black night and torchlight sweeping down spruce boughs. Wow, I made this really hard to read. My brow furrows with confusion. We're deep into the forest of Icefall, with no need to stop. Then I see it. The torchlight is steady, unmoving, like the flame itself has frozen. And if I look carefully, I can see the crumbling ash of my fortune taking a turn for the worse. There's no sound but my heartbeat rattling in my ears as the coach door slowly, quietly swings open. Nothing is there. Prickles run up the back of my neck. This could be the work of a gremlin, a wicked, hungry spirit looking for a meal. Then again, a gremlin wouldn't bother with these theatrics. I've dealt with two low gods since I was 4. I know when one's at work. And if I learned anything, it's that there's only one way to do business with a low god. Get it over with as soon as possible. I roll my eyes, peel myself from my nest of fur, and draw my hood up against the cold as I climb out of the coach. Sure enough, an inhuman figure towers in the road outside, wreathed in the forest mists, perhaps twice as tall as a man. The only reason my escort isn't fleeing is that they don't see her, or anything at all. Every rider, every soldier, every attendant has gone still, their torch flames stuck in place like lanterns of molten glass. That means, whichever low god this is, they're at least powerful enough to halt time a moment. That does not bode well. This low god has a bear skull for a head, twin red-tinged lights glowing in each eye socket. Two antlers branch from the crest of the skull, their tips blooming into blood-red leaves. A strange shadowy sphere floats between them. Long hair falls around the skull, parted perfectly down the middle, fading from jet-black roots to snow-white ends, and laced with bands of scarlet hemp. Two gaunt human arms thrust from a heap of shifting pelts like ribs from a long-dead corpse's jerkin, bone pale everywhere but the joints, which blush in a naturally deep crimson. A raven is perched on one of the branch antlers, its eyes also glowing red. Life and death, beast and vine, blood and bone, the teeth of a predator and the horns of prey. The goddess of this forest, then. Of course Icefall is strong enough to hold time. Her woods reach nearly all the way to the border itself. I curtsy with a bit more sincerity than I had for the junior prefect. Icefall? What? Silence, thief. It's a howl, a hiss, a snarl all in one. Oh, that can't be good. It's Lady Icefall to the likes of you. Did you think you could come into my land and take whatever you pleased? Did you think you would never pay? Icefall's voice rises to a shriek. I blink and she suddenly closed the distance, looming taller even than the coach, eyes burning scarlet. Did you think you could steal from mine? I don't know what you're talking about, I gasp, stumbling back. There's a bang. A glittering cloud pours from the open coach door. Everything I took from the Eisendorfs, hanging in midair like hornets. The pewter ring rises above them all, its moonstone shimmering in cold talons. This, Icefall snaps. This is a token of my protection. It is not yours to take. Etzbeta and Gustav don't need your protection, I fire back. Icefall only gnashes her teeth. Everyone in my woods needs my protection. They make their sacrifices every solstice.
They respect the old ways. They respect me. Easy to respect a god, I muttered, thinking of the look on Hans's face when Etveta screeched his name. Anyway, your token was just gathering dust in the bottom of a jewelry box. They weren't using it. But they are far from your only trespass, aren't they, little Vanya? The sound of my name knocks any answer from my tongue. For the last year, I've been Marta, Giselle, the Pennygeist. I have not answered to Vanya. I can't remember the last time someone called me by name. I've forgotten what it feels like. Icewald pushes closer, and I smell night and yarrow and rot. Do not think your godmothers can help you now. Take, take, take. That's all you've done for the last year, taken whatever you desire. But you have come into my woods tonight and stolen from those under my ward. So now, one pale hand reaches out, knuckles flushed red. My hood falls back on its own, the mink trim coiling like around my throat like a noose. I try to move, try to scream, but nothing. I can't even breathe, lungs afire, my sight filling with the cold dust of terrible luck. A burning cold fingertip presses to my cheek, just below my right eye. There's a sharp pain. I will give you a gift, Eiswald whispers and glides back. You will have what you want. I suck in a breath like a dagger in the gut. I can move again. My hand flies to my face and catches on something hard, no bigger than the tip of my little finger. Eiswald does not have lips to smile with, but the jaws of the bared skull crack a little wider. So torchlight slices along her teeth. Rubies and pearls you shall become, little Vanya, and you will know the price of being wanted. For true greed will do anything to take what... Wait. I strip off my glove and run my bare finger over whatever she's put on my cheek. It's too rough to be a pearl. Is this real? Eiswald tries again. To take what it... Is this a real ruby? I whip out my boot knife and check my dim reflection in the blade. Sure enough, a fat, impeccable teardrop-shaped ruby sits below my right eye. Shite, I breathe, and immediately prod at the stone with the tip of my knife. I could buy 5 horses with this. True greed, Eiswald thunders, will do anything to take what it wants. I shoot her a pointed look as the blade scrapes against a ruby, perhaps a little too close to my right eye. Admittedly, cutting gemstones out of my own face is not ideal, but 5 horses. Do you mind? I'm trying to concentrate. But no matter how I chisel at the jewel, it won't move, as if it's grown right out of my cheekbone. Eiswald knocks the knife aside anyway, seizing my chin in a grip that makes me squirm. Out of respect for your godmothers, I give you one more gift. Pass, I grind out. You have until the full moon to make up for what you have stolen, Eiswald growls. The longer you take, the more your greed will overtake you until it is all you are. The thing about low gods is they're inordinately fond of talking like a book of doomsday prophecies. You could ask Fortune about the weather, and she'd say something like, the wind's loyalty skews, the veil lifts, and that would mean the rain will clear out by Tuesday. The only way to get a straight answer from them is to spell it out first. So I'm going to keep breaking out in gemstones? By the full moon, you be gemstones and nothing more. The only way to save yourself is to shed your greed and make amends for what I took. Right, I heard you the first time. I purse my lips. If I'm spreading jewels like warts, maybe I've solved at least my money problem. Are they all going to grow on my face or somewhere less necessary? Enough, you grow tiresome. Eiswald flicks a hand and the raven flutters down from her antlers to alight on one ready tip fingertip. My daughter Ragna will watch over you until my gift ends, one way or another. Your curse, you mean. I eye the raven as the gravity of the situation begins to sink in. Eiswald tilts her head, and the leaves on her antlers shiver. It will be what you make of it, little Vanya. One of the first scenes that actually occurred to me was just her getting cursed and be like, oh man, I could like sell this for so much money.
Are there any questions?
Would you be interested in having your story turned into like a visual format, like TV or a film? Like, is that something that like you see in your mind or when you're writing? I guess it's kind of two different questions. So, like, 'cause it's so visual to me when you're reading it.
I'm a very visual person. Like, there's always this little image that goes around about every 3 months. That's like, on a scale of 1 to 5, when someone tells you to picture an apple, what do you see? And it's like a blob or nothing, all the way to like a perfectly photographic apple. And I'm usually like at the photographic apple, maybe a little bit less. And so I see things playing out in like as I'm writing them. Mm-hmm. So it would be really, really cool to see an adaptation. The one trick is that fantasy adaptations are known for being or needing huge budgets. So I think there has to be a pretty big fan base behind it for a studio to be like, this is where I want to go. But it would be really cool.
There will be any questions in chats?
Not yet.
Okay. I do have a question.
Okay, and if you guys have any questions too, throw them in the chat.
Yeah. I love the story. And one of the things that immediately I was attracted to is the whole godmother concept.
Mm-hmm.
Because in Latino culture, I mean, we have several godparents. We have godparents for everything.
Oh,
and in some kind of circles, they call them, you know, sponsors.
Mm-hmm.
In other circles, they call them padrinos or madrinas. And that's what, so it's the concept that I've grown up with. But it really kind of talks to, you know, having someone look over you and kind of provide some guidance or mentoring. Did you ever have anybody like that?
Oh, man. I think at several points in my life, I've had, you know, a teacher who will, you know, reach out a little bit or push me to go a little harder, push me a little bit further. And that's always been great. So hilariously, I applied for honors English and AP English in school, and I didn't make it. And I think, like, not for nothing, I think I am the only published author in my graduating class. But you know, I think there was a little bit of a string pull there, because at least for my senior year, because they wouldn't, you know, I wasn't good enough for AP English, but they did put me in the other English class that teacher taught. So it was like, well, we can get close as we can. But yeah, no, I think there've been like teachers, coworkers who have looked out for me, and that's been great. But the one of the things that actually inspired the godmothers is so my parents split up when I was like 4 or 5, and you know, sometimes when they split, it's not always they don't have the best relationship, and they won't necessarily be like, you have to pick sides. But as an adult, you look back and you're like, oh, this was you trying to get me to go one way or the other. And I kind of wanted to write around that relationship where you have two parents that you love very much, and they love you very much in their own way. But they are also like, there's something going on with them where they are trying to get you to choose, like to pick a favorite, and you don't want to do that at all. And it's like, how do I reconcile, you know, loving both my parents, but also becoming aware of their flaws? Because they'll be like, well, your dad is this, or your mom always does this. And having sort of almost a sabotage of the typical thing of, you know, you defer to your parents. They're these ultimate perfect authorities. And like when at age 6, your parents are like, well, your mom, you know, I wasn't like a wild rebel child, but I was also like, okay, so my parents aren't perhaps, you know, quite as infallible as they're presenting themselves. Like, I can question this.
Yeah.
And having that kind of tension of knowing that your parents are imperfect, but loving you, but also knowing that what they want for you is wrong. And also that what they want for you is in conflict, and choosing one or the other is going to mean alienating one.
Yeah.
So I also love the idea of, like, we all love this idea of having like this guardian figure or someone who's like, I want to keep an eye out and make sure that you get a little bit further ahead. Mm-hmm. I want to do that. I want to make your life a little bit easier. But sometimes those are great, and sometimes those have strings attached.
Yeah. A slight course correction sometimes. Yeah.
Right.
Have you ever had a chance to go back to the person who said no to admitting me to the AP English.
I don't know who. And like, to be fair, I think I was also a little bit of a scatterbrained little kid. So I'm sure there was like some paper that like someone was supposed to, like a parent was supposed to sign or something, and I didn't turn that in. But I, you know, I went through the exams, I went through the application process. So no, I think one of the things, and like, I'm going to sound like I'm talking like an ancient person right now. I'm not like, you know, everyone would be like, you know, those, back in the day, or, you know, in my ancient wisdom. But I do think one thing about getting older is you go from holding on to the pain or in the frustration that you felt when you were younger to recognizing when it no longer serves you. And, you know, at the time, as a kid in high school, I was devastated. I was like, you know, my best friend got in, why didn't I? And that, I think, ultimately wound up serving me almost better because I got used to a lot of rejection. And like I said about querying, you have to go through dozens, you have to send dozens, if not hundreds, of query letters and get told no, 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 again and again. And that being rejected a lot when you are younger, when you have that kind of emotional resiliency to some degree, can help you build the coping mechanisms to be like, this is working, this isn't, but this is a dream that I really care about. Or to say, this isn't working and I don't know how to fix it and I'm not helping myself by clinging to it. So ultimately, I look back on that and it's like the story that's told about Oprah, right? I think Leslie Jones was the one talking about how Oprah, you know, got fired, or, you know, I think it was, yeah, that she got fired from a job when she was like in her 20s. And Leslie was saying, or someone was like, oh, do you want to be the person who fired Oprah? And Leslie Jones had this great point of saying, well, but she wasn't Oprah then, and she had to get fired to become Oprah. So, yeah, it's I like to tell myself that, especially in the mirror every morning, and be like, someday I'll be Oprah. Yeah.
Yeah. So, like the thing with the this novel, it's written. I always kind of feel it's like, you know, writing a novel entirely in present tense. You know, you do that if it's like, you do that if it's in contrast with, like, you know, things happening in the past and present. But, like, mm-hmm. I always figure, you know, like, because I always seem to me when something's written in present tense, it's like, it's like you're describing the same reoccurring story that happens over and over, same situation that happens over and over again. Like, maybe, like, with the children's book, you want to get that idea that it's the same situation that keeps happening over and over again. But when it's kind of a lengthy novel, that... when it's a novel in that situation, you know, that I've never understood exactly the way to do it unless it's supposed to be in contrast with the past and present.
It's, you know, there's different uses for, I think, for each tense and each point of view. So with Little Thieves, actually, it starts in past tense third person because it's so within the book, there are seven different interstitials, and each one is told like a fairy tale, but it's actually a flashback for part of Wanya's life. And so the each of those are told in third person like they are fairy tales or in past tense. And then when you switch to the immediate present, what that does is puts us right in Wanya's POV as it's happening. And the thing with Wanya is over the course of the book, like, she starts out sort of very closed off, even from the reader. And she starts off closed off in a way that's very much, I'm going to deflect everything that's happening to me with humor and sass, and I'm going to pretend that I'm not affected by any of this at all, and I'm just going to keep on girl bossing my way through this. And then throughout the course of the book, you see her sort of, you see a little bit of her, of the, like, her interior dialogue shift, and also as she's, like, you know, opening up a little bit, and that, you know, that was very deliberate. So you could see that, or you could have that interiority and see how much she's even closed off from herself versus how that sort of develops over time into something that's a little, it's both self-aware, but like self-aware in a way that's like, this past behavior hasn't been good for me. And then she just sort of chucks that all out the window and painted devils. It's great. It's just a regression. It's great. Yeah.
It sounded like, from what, when you're explaining it earlier, like when you're in school, that you knew you wanted to be a writer kind of like early on. Mm-hmm. But then of course, like, it's really hard to like navigate your way through life and earning income and right. writing, you know, paying for rent or whatever it is. But mm-hmm. so like, what advice do you have for people who like want, who kind of know that they want to do something and they yeah. want to pursue a dream, but they still have to buy food and
right. rent? So this is actually a surprisingly controversial question. Because I think people feel very strongly about wanting the arts to be accessible for everybody, and also about not telling people how to live or how to pursue creativity. And the reality is that there are no two careers are the same, and that's, you know, that's fine. I would say what worked for me was, unfortunately, to some degree, drop kicking my social life and prioritizing my work. And that doesn't, like, some people will say, you know, you have to write every day, you have to write somehow something. That's not necessarily accurate. Sometimes you will sit down in my experience, that's also led to like me sitting down and staring at a document I resent so much I can't write, and that only builds the more that I can't write. And I don't recommend, you know, like sticking to anything that's like really, you know, very specific. What's the word I'm looking for? Prescriptive. Like, I don't have any like prescriptive sort of axioms to throw out like that. I will say, on the practical term, you want to look at, or before going full time, before quitting your day job, you want to look at what you're being offered and ask yourself, at least in the fiction world, if this is paid out over, you know, like the period, like let's say you have a book that's coming, or like, you know, they want to buy it today, and it's going to publish in, you know, 2 years from now. You have to ask yourself if what they're offering is going to cover your expenses for 2 years. And when it's like a multi-book deal, you want to basically take that number, like however many books it is, and add 1 to 2 to it. And as that total number is how many years you're committing to this. And you want to look at, actually, to be technical, if 85% of that is going to cover your taxes, your rent, all your living expenses, because 15% is going to go to your agent as a commission that they 1,000% earn. It's well deserved, but it's in terms of practicality, you have to be very very realistic about what you are signing up for. And so I say, be practical about that. And do recognize that you are probably going to have to say no to some things, but also you shouldn't say no to everything, because otherwise you are just going to find yourself building a resentful relationship with your work. So like, there are parties that I would say, oh, I can't go to this. Or, you know, someone would be like, do you want to go get some beers? And I was like, no, you know, not tonight, but not every time. I would still, you know, have to deliberately go out and engage socially. And I mean, that sounds very robotic, but meet more, I will get my social engagement now. But it's a, you know, you do want to go out and experience other people, you know, and get the reminders of people who exist outside of your own head.
A quick follow-up.
Yeah.
Did your parents, I think you said it was your dad who like wanted you to be an accountant or something different, well, but was he like, you did the right thing?
So, I love my parents. You're right. Well, if there's a Priscilla Maloney in the chat, yes, she's gotta go. You gotta move. Also, for anyone online who sees their Instagram posts getting liked by Priscilla Maloney, I am putting my mom on blast. That is fair. My mom definitely wanted me to be a lawyer growing up, and like, to be fair to both of them, they were like, we want you to pick a path that, you know, sings to you, and you have these talents that we see based on the numerical measures of, you know, of various exams and standardized tests and stuff, and they wanted, like, they were like, basically, we support you, but we also want you to have a real career. And then when I was like, I want to be a comic artist, they were like, well, you're going to go to college at some point, right? Yeah, okay. You're going to figure it out. And the funny thing is, when I broke the news to my dad that I had sold sold books in a 3-book deal, he initially thought it was like to a vanity press. And until I had to send him like the actual like news thing that like there's a couple of different industry journals, Publishers Weekly and Publishers Marketplace. And I think it's kind of like the Publishers Weekly announcement. And he was like, oh, you actually sold like real books. And I'm like, yeah. Thank you for the vote of confidence. Keeping me humble. Usually that's my cast job. All right. And I mean, the funny thing is, so back in May, thanks to all the support from my wonderful readers, I actually debuted on the New York Times list for the first time. And thank you. It was really cool. And I had like a catch-up call with my dad about a month later, and I told him, also if there's a Ted Owen in the chat, he's gotta go too. But I told him like, yeah, so I hit the New York Times list, and he's like, wow, that's really great, you know, that's really cool, Mal. And then I was like, oh yeah, and I also went to the Gorge and saw Joni Mitchell in concert, and he was like, what? And he just absolutely lost his mind.
Priorities.
It was, that was an experience. It was fantastic. But also, I was like, thanks, Dad. Thank you. Once again, for confirming my career choice. But he reads my books. He's very supportive. So, like, I'm dunking on him. It's nice to have parents who are supportive and aren't like, oh, well, this is just a hobby. You're never going to make money. It's like, no, actually, I'm making more money doing this than I have made for the countless other real jobs that I was miserable at. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that was, I feel lucky in that regard. And also, he went from being a graphic designer to a music therapist. So again, like, no grounds to judge here.
We do have a few questions from the chat now.
Yeah.
So the first one is, what was the inspiration for Rug?
So I'm going to, okay, this is probably going to set off a minor bomb on Instagram. So initially, when I was thinking about Little Thieves, I wanted every character to be a foil to Vanya in some way, but originally, it was just going to be like, you know, okay, so there's Giselle, and then there's this, the child of the forest deity. So for folks who haven't read Little Thieves, Ragna is basically Eiswald's daughter. And or like, yeah, she got introduced in the thing I just read. But yeah, she's just this feral half-human, half-god shapeshifter who bounces around the thing. And I wanted her to be this complete foil to Vanya as someone who's very trusting and like not necessarily naive, but she's going from a world where it's like, well, we sniff each other's butts and now we're cool, to like people who are like, well, I'm going to pretend to like someone, but I don't really like them. But also I want this person to know that I'm only pretending, but I don't want that person to know. And she's just like, why are you making this so difficult? Like, can't you just sniff each other's butts? Like, again, I don't understand. And, originally, that character was going to be a boy and a love interest for Vanya. And as I was like picking at that, I was like, I don't like the idea that this character has been assigned to look over this, you know, over the main character and sort of like both almost police her, ironically, and also be a protector. I feel like that sets up a weird power dynamic that can't really be, or and also, you know, but it was when Ragna was a boy, it was like, you know, then his mom also cursed her. So that's, you know, this is the sense of some stuff that I'm not sure I want to get into. And also, I don't think it's going to be necessarily the right, like, they're good foils, but they'd be better as friends. And it's not necessarily a romantic dynamic that I think would be right or appealing to someone like Vanya. And then when I was like, okay, what if we had this complete dork ass, like, nerdy little investigator who was also just like, excuse me, you seem to be breaking a rule or several. Let me read them out from memory. But also, was it like, I'll just like a smidge of badass, but like, you know, only the faintest sprinkling of it. That I was like, okay, that would be a much more interesting dynamic. And then they're like,
Well, and also, Rhonda doesn't have, or like, Lonnie doesn't have any girlfriends. Like, she's got Giselle, who turned on her, and then she's got her friend Joniza, who is no longer part of her life at this point. And she doesn't have any, like, best friends, and I want her to have a friend. And when I made that adjustment to the dynamic, I was like, this is infinitely better. This gives Vanya someone to actually bond with outside of like a romantic agenda and just have sort of unequivocal support, and that kind of unequivocal support that doesn't have strings attached, but also does have some boundaries of like Ragna being like, you can't talk to me like this. You are being mean, and I'm going to say so. And having that kind of presence in her life is ultimately what allows her to open up to other people, to connecting with other people. So that is where Ragna came from.
Okay, got another one. So you talked about the short tale that inspired Little Thieves. Mm-hmm. Could you talk about how your writing process of how you take an idea and build that into a book? And what sort of questions do you ask yourself about your work? It's very magical that it'll be a full trilogy, and I'd really like to hear how it works.
Oh, thank you. There's a couple layers to this question. How do I take an idea how do I develop it into a full book? And that's slightly tied to actually what questions do I ask myself about my work? So when I have an idea, usually I will start asking, Little Thieves, it started as like, not just like actually the Goose Girl. I started with the idea, like this one idea of like, I want to tell a story about someone who is bad in a petty way, but very good at it, being cursed into doing good deeds and being very bad at it. And then I also was like, I had a D&D character whose backstory was being criminally underutilized, and it's very similar to Vanya's. And I was like, I want to make something out of that. And I also wanted to tell a story about like a con artist character. And I basically combined all three of those into one concept. And then I looked at it and I was like, well, this would be a story about a con artist who has stolen the identity of the person that her former boss. I could basically backwards park this into a Goose Girl retelling. And that's what I did. But from there, the questions that you ask are like that I asked to develop it is like, what kind of setting, you know, could or should or would make this character? So with this, it would be a setting where the treatment of servants is relatively poor and there's not a lot of regulation of that. It would be a setting where magic exists because there's a curse. It would be a setting where gods exist because, you know, that kind of sort of fits nicely of like there's gods to curse people, but also they have these, you know, they interact with and influence the plots in these ways and fill some holes there. And asking, do I want this to be reminiscent of, like, do I want it to set this straight up in like fantasy Germany, like, or historical-ish Germany, or do like a second world that's Germany themed, which is where I wound up going with that. So I asked questions like that. I asked questions about like, are there dialects and languages in this, and how does that impact things, you know, and how I name things and how people talk and how different people from different areas interact with each other, what different religions are present, because you're not going to have a religious monolith except for unless it's a very closed area, and then you have to engage with that and be like, how does this area maintain its population, keep outside influence from entering? So you basically have to start just asking, you have to be like a little toddler and start going, why? And I mean, like, ultimately the question that I always start with is like, where does the poop go? Which is not a glamorous question, but it is like, when you answer that question, you answer what technology level they're at and what, you know, to some degree, what kind of societal hierarchies you have, because you have someone whose job it is to take the poop away. And how are they treated by society? Because, I mean, we all know that a garbage strike is pretty much the worst thing that can happen to a city. And yet, sometimes garbage people have to go on strike. So clearly we're not actually, you know, treating them with the respect that they always 100% deserve. So yeah, like once you answer that, like, do they use a poop? Do they have a hole in the ground? What technology level is available to them? And you can start asking, like, okay, has magic contributed to this technology, to this level of engineering? And that is the kind of stuff that I use to build the world after I've gotten the idea. And basically, like, at the same time, I'm populating it with characters who are going to hold different roles in this world, and then looking at how those characters and these different elements of the setting and world impact the plot. So that's usually how I go about it. And then, like, once I've got, a little bit more of an idea of what this world looks like and what the structure is and, you know, where I want the plot to go, I have a whole thing on Instagram, actually, like a couple of different areas where I go through how I take that into, build an outline based on that and then develop that outline further. But the short answer is I basically do almost like, in our terms, it would be a thumbnail sketch, but it's like a very broad outline of the events I want to have happen. I break that into however many acts there are. And then I start with the first act and I flesh that out more. And sometimes I'll do like first, second, maybe third, and have like a little bit of fleshing out, but I'll leave the end relatively open other than like, I know that I have to hit these benchmarks. And then I'll go to the very first act again, take the fleshed out outline, and then flesh it out even further into chapter descriptions, or either chapter descriptions or a series of more detailed bullet points of actual scenes and events that happen. And then I will take a couple of those and move it over to a different document and write out an entire outline for a chapter. And it's basically a zero draft of a chapter. So it's me telling myself what happens, and then I draft from that.
Wow.
But it means that I have, like, I don't have a whole lot of plot holes to resolve at the end, and that saves me a lot of time later.
We have, I think we have time for one or two.
Yeah.
We don't have any more in chat.
I have one last one. Yeah. Maybe if we can, if you have, are you okay with one?
Totally. Yeah, we have time.
I read a lot of gothic contemporary fiction last year.
Yeah.
And from a lot of Latino authors.
Well,
Are there any genres that you are, or like just that you are interested in maybe exploring?
Oh, so many. I like just in the last month, I got an idea for a rom-com that I want to write, but I might do that under a pen name because sometimes people get a little weird when you switch genres that much.
Yeah.
I have looked at, and I have an idea for a thriller I really like. When I was in the end stages of drafting the third book, I wound up on this, but I was looking up something about alchemy, and I found a Wikipedia article for something that I was like, how is this not already like a book, a movie, a Netflix series, and a documentary? And so, I think it sets itself or lends itself really well to almost like a Da Vinci Code-esque adult fantasy. So that is something that is on the books now. So yeah, those are different areas I definitely want to branch out into. And it's always good because we've seen with publishing there are trends and things. Some things are more popular. Some things come and go, and it's good to have. I think it's good to have range, like it's good to be really good at one thing, but I like also being, not to toot my own horn, I like being good at lots of things. I like being a Swiss Army knife, right? I like having the range to explore. So ideally that would be that. I think if I ever become less of a chicken, horror would be fun because I do like writing like really visceral stuff, maybe like a gothic fic, gothic horror-ish stuff. That would be really fun. I do like, I was joking that when I was coming up with a magic system for Little Thieves, which is you burn gods and monsters, or the hair, the nail clippings of gods and monsters, and then consume that, and it gives you like brief bits of power. I was joking that I was like, my publisher wanted me so badly to have a normal magic system for once, because my debut, you the main character pulls magic from dead people's teeth. And I was like, yeah, no, I can do a normal one. And then now it's eat the gods for power. So who knows? I feel like that there's clearly a bent for some gothic-ish supernatural stuff.
That's great. We look. I certainly pick it up.
Thank you. I'll see what I can do.
Do we have any other questions?
Just one final question that I'd like to ask is, can you tell us anything about what you're reading now or maybe looking forward to reading soon?
Oh, man.
I'd love to hear about people's to-be-read piles and or reading piles.
gosh, I actually started, I wonder if I have it on my phone. I started a reading list for the adult fantasy. It was reading notes or, it's not just like specifically for that, but also books that I want to read in general. I don't read books to just hate on them, but because I've only got so much time in the day. I wonder if I have it. I know how I do it. Yeah, there it is. Okay, so number one is Starling House. I'm so excited to read that. I want to read If We Were Villains, Portrait of the Thief, and the Emily Wilde series.
Mm-hmm.
So that is my adult fantasy reading list right now. But I'm probably going to add some more stuff to it.
So you keep a list in your phone?
I found myself being like, I need to read this book. I need to read this book. Oh, I want to read this book so bad. And I don't use Goodreads. That's the bad place. Goodreads is like, It's not a place for authors, I think, is at the end of the day. But unfortunately, it means that I get limited to what I can be like. The one thing I use Goodreads for is looking at bad reviews of books I love to remind myself that I'm not the only one. Just be like, oh no, this book that I love just got so badly misinterpreted in this review. So I can put that away. I can remember that I'm not uniquely bad. And people aren't uniquely misreading my work. But it also does take away a tool for tracking my TBR, right? And so do all the book rating tracking websites. So I just have to keep a list in my phone.
Margaret, thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you to everyone who was visiting us online. And on behalf of the Seattle Public Library and the Washington Center for the Book, thank you. If you want to learn more about you, you have your dedicated author website.
It is so out of date. That's like my first thing once I get off deadline is to update my website. I can think of several authors who will yell at me for not updating my website. But you can find me on Blue Sky and Tumblr and Instagram right now, all at what_eats_owls or what-eats_owls. The question remains.
Well, thank you so much again.
thank you for having me.